The Australian Financial Review.
The Murdochs and Pratts have built multi-billion dollar global empires that started as small family businesses in Australia. They've come to dominate their respective industries and created immense wealth to hand down to the next generation. But now, both families are locked in bitter legal disputes.
Rupert Murdoch and his eldest four children were in Reno, Nevada for the first day of a court case that will potentially help determine who will be in control of Rupert Murdoch's vast media empire after Rupert Murdoch, who is in his mid-90s, passes away.
This week, we begin a two-part series on succession. First, we look at the secret court case underway in Reno, Nevada, where Rupert Murdoch, along with his son and chosen successor Lachlan, will face off against three of his other children.
I think there's likely to be a permanent alienation within the Murdoch family, because when your lawyer cross-examines another member of your family, it's not a pleasant process. But if the three siblings do win their case, then I think Lachlan's position after Rupert's death looks like toast.
Next week, we'll discuss the legal fight over the Pratt packaging fortune that has upended a carefully designed inheritance plan. Welcome to The Fin. I'm Lisa Murray. Today, senior writer Neil Chenoweth and media and marketing reporter Sam Buckingham-Jones on why Lachlan Murdoch's position as successor is in doubt, what Rupert is trying to do about it, and whether he can win. It's Thursday, September 19. Sam, Neil, thanks for coming on the podcast.
It's great to be here.
Hi, Lisa.
Sam, the Murdoch family succession saga has it all. A secret court battle, a family divided, and the future of the conservative media in America on the line. Tell us what this legal fight is all about.
So, from Monday this week, a court in Reno, Nevada has hosted the sort of juicy family drama made famous by Succession, the HBO TV show, which is loosely based on the Murdochs. So, this is a case of art imitating life. Rupert and his chosen heir, Lachlan, are on one side, while Lachlan's siblings, Elizabeth, James and Prudence, are on the other. And that was shown in how they arrived at court on Monday morning. A row of black SUVs dropped off Elizabeth, James and Prudence, and about half an hour later, Rupert and Lachlan arrived. This intra-family war over the future of the Murdoch empire began back in October 30 last year when Rupert filed a court case to have this Murdoch family trust changed.
Australian media mogul Rupert Murdoch wants to amend his family's trust to give full control of his business empire to his son Lachlan Murdoch.
Rupert wants Lachlan in sole control of the empire that spans Fox News, The Australian, The New York Post, The Sun and The London Times.
Fox Corporation and News Corporation are the two companies that the Murdochs have control over. And Lachlan is in charge at the moment, but he is worried that his siblings will effectively force him out when Rupert dies. This is obviously pretty concerning for Rupert, who has, you know, chosen Lachlan after decades of speculation to be his heir, the person to run his conservative media empire. And so Rupert's gambit is to reshape this Murdoch family trust and make the case that Lachlan is the best person to run it. He is the person with the business credentials who can benefit all of the trustees of this trust, all of his other siblings, essentially. And this move by Rupert has been named Project Harmony, which feels like this whole thing is made for TV. But this may be one of the greatest challenges that Rupert has ever faced. He's gone up against the biggest, the most powerful media people in the world. This time, the greatest threat actually comes from his own family.
And Sam, why is it happening in Reno, Nevada?
Reno, Nevada is this town in the middle of a desert in the US.
This is a city of glitter and glamour, a city of neon and bright lights, of spinning
wheels. It's a casino city.
This is Reno, the biggest little city in the world.
It's got a population smaller than Geelong.
Reno, Nevada, a fabulous town.
It's a gambling haven, but it's also a trust haven. Nevada as a state, it's almost like the Swiss banking sort of area, but for trusts. And that's for a bunch of reasons. There's no inheritance tax. They prioritise secrecy, crucially. They also have what's known as a dynasty trust, which allows for trusts to last as long as 365 years. So in contrast, you know, California, right next door, has maximum trust length less than a third of that time.
Uh-huh.
And so that's why the Murdochs and many wealthy families set up trusts in Nevada. But this case is shrouded in secrecy by the very laws that make Nevada such an appealing place to create a trust. The details of it only emerged in July. So think about that. This is one of the most high-profile media families in the world, and it took a good 9 months for anyone outside their sort of core set to actually even discover that this battle was happening. This is the who's who of succession battle cases. And the lawyers are very high profile. The three Murdoch siblings are represented by a man named Gary Bornstein from Cravath, Swain & Moore, a very high profile US law firm. And Rupert and Lachlan are represented by a guy called Adam Streisand.
I've been a trial lawyer for more than 30 years.
Who is a trial lawyer at Shepherd Mullen.
I don't watch Succession. I don't know if you do, but it's just too close to home for me. But that's what we do every day.
He has represented Michael Jackson and Britney Spears.
The legal issues are fascinating, but I'm a storyteller, right? That's what I do as a trial lawyer. And there are no more compelling stories than the stories of our relationships with our family. I mean, that's why worldwide literature is so rich in family disputes and family disputes.
And something that I found very, very funny here is that since this case was filed, Streisand has updated his professional biography on the Shepherd Mullen website, and it includes this line. If you've seen it on HBO's Succession, Adam Streisand has litigated it, and much more, in real life.
Wow, I'm surprised that Rupert and Lachlan allowed that to happen.
I wonder if they were asked.
So, Neil, this case is about succession. A year ago, Lachlan appeared to have won the battle after he was announced Rupert's successor as head of both News Corp and Fox. But now, as Sam said, Rupert and Lachlan are attempting to cement that transition by changing the family trust. Take us through the history of the trust. When and why was it set up?
You've got to remember that Murdochs have had trusts of some sort since at least the 1930s. Now, it's all about tying up money and power. So when Rupert divorced his wife Anna in 1999, there are all sorts of stories. First of all, that she got $1 billion Australian, and then it became $1 billion US, and then it became £1 billion. None of these stories was true. What she got was about $200 million, and that included a Manhattan apartment. Under California law, she could have asked for half of the whole thing, but she didn't on one condition, and that condition was that Rupert undertakes in an irrevocable trust to ensure that after his death, all four of the then children, and now that's Elizabeth, Lachlan and James, that Anna and Rupert had, and Prudence, the elder daughter from Rupert Murdoch's first wife, would all have equal shares, equal power and equal wealth.
Mm-hmm.
So that whole ethos of treating all of the children equally has been a very powerful one. Anna had this fear about succession battles causing family breakups. She'd even written a whole novel called Family Business about a family that really self-destructs in the course of a succession battle. So it was a big thing for her. Now, on the other side of that, Rupert Murdoch, from his point of view, when his father died, he inherited about 33, 34% of what was the trust's then, and he was able to maintain his iron grip on his empire despite initially having a non-controlling stake. Now, the way the trust works is that each of those four adult children was able to appoint one director to the trust. So that's one director, one vote. That's four votes in all. At the same time, Rupert Murdoch also controls four votes. They're held by two directors, William Barr, the former Trump Attorney General, and the head of News Corp, Robert Thompson. So the plan is when Rupert Murdoch dies, His directors resigned, and that leaves the four adult children in charge. Now the trust is actually split six ways, because back in 2005, Rupert's third wife, Wendy Deng, insisted that her two daughters, Grace and Chloe, should have an equal share. Now that triggered a whole rift within the family, which was resolved when it was decided, yes, they would all have equal shares, but Grace and Chloe would not have voting stakes. What's in this whole black box of the trust? To be frank, there's a lot less here than there used to be. Back in March 21, it was worth about $26 billion US. And that was largely because of these Disney shares, which had soared from the original price that they obtained them. But they've since halved. So the assets in the trust are now worth about $15.1 billion US. That's a drop of about $11 billion in the last 2 years. Mm. Now, that's changed the dynamics also within the trust, because at various stages, the Murdochs have floated the fact that Lachlan could sell his Disney shares and use that to buy his siblings out of Fox Corp and News Corp. That's no longer a realistic option. And this has coincided with unrest, which the family perceives as being generated by James, to challenge Lachlan's future control of the empire. And that's the kind of context for this boiling family feud.
And where do the allegiances lie within the family? Clearly, Rupert and Lachlan are aligned, but what about the other siblings in the court case? They're on the same side in this case because they feel disenfranchised by Rupert's move, but in future, are they likely to vote together?
That was always the big question mark. James promoted the view last year that the three kids would roll Lachlan as soon as their father died. And that's up to debate. I was skeptical about it. Prudence, no one really seems to know exactly what she thinks. However, the fact that her father has brought this change has kind of crystallized the lines very clearly that all three of them are strongly opposed to it. Rupert, from the start, I think, has always regarded Lachlan as the first among equals, as he would express it. But they all have significant track record. Elizabeth has made a series of successful private investments in production companies that she's run. James, I think his major achievement has been the way he transformed B Sky B, which was the satellite broadcaster that News Corp founded in 1999. It was on James's watch that B Sky B became the real media powerhouse that it is in the UK. But it's not James's track record that's at stake here. It's Lachlan. And is he the best choice to continue to run Fox and News?
For their entire lives, all of these siblings have been encouraged to compete. In every interview I've seen where Rupert has been asked this explicit question,
is your son Lachlan the natural heir apparent?
He always replies with a broadly similar response, which is,
well, I've got another son and a daughter. And we'll have to see how they work it out. I hope not fight it out.
Of course, I think that's natural, but they need to prove themselves.
It could be very nice. It's every father's natural desire to see, I think, his children follow him if they're up to it, but they've got to prove themselves first.
So in Rupert's eyes, Lachlan seems to have won that battle. He has been chosen as he's now chairman of News Corp. He is executive chairman of Fox Corporation. Those are the two main assets there. So Lachlan seems to have won this battle. You know, the lady's a lot like Reno. So this commissioner at a court in Reno is going to decide whether Rupert is acting in good faith by bringing this case. And Rupert is really going to make this argument that a Lachlan-led media dynasty is best for everyone. It is economically in everyone's interests for Lachlan to be in charge here. I know she's a lot like Reno. So in some ways, a way of describing this lawsuit is as a referendum on Lachlan's leadership. You couldn't have scripted it better if you tried. This will be a court case to decide whether Lachlan Murdoch is a good businessman. Lot like Reno.
Neil, we're talking about the court case happening this week in Nevada that will determine who controls one of the most powerful media companies in the world. Rupert Murdoch is trying to change the family's trust to ensure his eldest son and chosen successor, Lachlan, stays in charge. And to do that, ultimately, he'll have to prove that Lachlan is the best person to manage the group and protect its commercial value. Will Lachlan's track record stand up to scrutiny?
Lachlan has some big wins on his side, but it's a mixed bag. First of all, there was the OneTel disaster. OneTel was the mobile phone company that Jody Rich had founded and convinced James Packer and Lachlan Murdoch to invest in. And they invested about $1.4 billion between them, which was lost. The other problem area has been as the investment that he made in 10, which with James Packer, which just turned out to be a complete debacle and lost $1 billion of shareholder funds. His great move is that News Corp in Australia invests in REA. REA is a digital advertising company specialising in property, began in Australia but has since expanded into the United States and into Europe. And today, in US dollars, it's worth $10.9 billion. So this is a major win that he has. He seems to be most successful where he lets other people manage as opposed to his father, who kind of gets stuck in there. He sits back and oversees it. So overall, Lachlan has had some big wins, but there have also been some bumps and stumbles along the way. But there's enough to justify him having the position that he has.
Yeah, it's really hard to understate the success of that REA investment. He put in $2.2 million in cash, an extra $8 or so in advertising contra. So that's free advertising on News Corp. And so News Corp has an entire market value of about $22 billion Australian dollars. $16 billion of that is REA. Just this week, James Packer was quoted as describing it as,
REA is the best media deal ever done in Australia.
So does that outweigh previous missteps? I guess that's what a court's going to decide. But REA has undoubtedly been one of News Corp's best investments. Every other media company in Australia has dropped by 40% this calendar year. News Corp is up. That alone. Just think about the differential there. That's massive.
Sam, this court case has left News Corp vulnerable to activist shareholders who've long railed against the company's dual-class share structure. Explain how this structure works and also how this case is being used by at least one opportunistic investor to push for change.
So this is not an uncommon structure in US corporate circles. Essentially, there are two classes of shares. In News Corp's case, there are Class A shares and there are Class B shares. One of these shares has a vote in the future of the company and the other doesn't. So this allows somebody to hold a smaller stake in a company, but to retain outsized control. So one of News Corp's quite substantial shareholders, a hedge fund called Starboard Value, went public in the last few weeks with its call to collapse those two different shareholder classes into one. And Starboard wrote this open letter to the board saying that the Murdoch family has a 14% economic stake in News Corp, but has 41% of the vote. So the managing member of Starboard is a guy called Jeffrey Smith. He wrote this letter saying, and this is the quote, "Dual class share structures are not, capital N-O-T, in the best interests of shareholders and are not reflective of the best-in-class corporate governance practices." And then he jumped straight into the trust dispute in Reno. He said, "The transition from Rupert to his children has let complicated family dynamics and different opinions about News Corp and Fox Corp impact the company's stability." So this is starting to hit the, you know, the hip pocket of investors here.
You've got to remember, back in 2015, there was a shareholder motion to collapsed the whole the voting and non-voting shares, which is who Rupert Murdoch keeps control of both News and Fox, into one class. And that failed by 0.5%. That's about $13 million worth of shares, which is nothing. That happened after News Corp brought its annual general meeting forward a month, and so a whole bunch of shares that had been bought to vote on this issue couldn't vote. So the idea that the Murdoch's position is unassailable is not based on history there. So there's a whole bunch of unknowns about what the Murdoch control will look like after their father's death.
I guess one thing that has been pointed out is that this call actually could benefit Lachlan in his bid here in Reno, because the impact that this court case is having is already destabilizing the company. And I guess Lachlan could argue that him being in charge is that stability. If he is solidified in that role, then the company is, you know, stable into the future as it has been under Rupert.
So potentially at stake in this courtroom drama are the political leanings of both News Corp, with its papers such as the Wall Street Journal and the Australian and the Daily Telegraph in Australia, and Fox News. What are the broader ramifications for the media industry if the other children win this case? Would they, as Lachlan and Rupert think they would, reverse the right-wing journalism of the media group?
The siblings have clearly been uncomfortable with the strategic direction of Fox. It's on the public record what some of the kids' political views are. James donates to the Democratic Party. He recently signed a letter alongside 80-something other business leaders in the US endorsing Kamala Harris as president. That is in stark contrast to the worldview that Fox News puts out there. So when he left News in 2020, he cited disagreements over some editorial content. He also criticised outlets that, quote, propagate lies to their audience. In 2021, after the riot at the US Capitol building, that was seen as a pretty clear reference to Fox News, which, you know, had spent months airing these claims that the election might have been rigged and ended up having to pay an $800 million settlement to a voting machine company called Dominion because of those lies. That's a $1.2 billion Australian dollar fine. But at the same time, there's this sort of commercial tension here that those Fox viewers are very sensitive and clearly want fawning coverage of Donald Trump.
And it's ironic because Rupert and Lachlan really don't like Trump. And you have the strange kind of prospect here that if Trump becomes the next US president, every member of the Murdoch family on both sides of this court case, they will be united in being uncomfortable because they're not pro-Trump, but they don't want to kill the goose that lays the golden egg. At the basic level, this is a fight over ideology within the family. You've got three more moderate siblings, and then you've got Lachlan and his father. The argument that Rupert Murdoch is putting is that any attempt to change the ideological lean of Fox News and News Corp will make News and Fox less profitable. So would a less right-wing Fox News be less profitable? We saw maybe a glimpse of that in the 2020 election when, after the Fox News made that historic Arizona call in favour of Joe Biden, you saw serious falls in the viewer numbers for Fox News and inroads being made by smaller operators like Newsmax. But the reality is, in the long term, the smaller alternatives just aren't in the same ballpark as Fox News. Its position is still strong.
There's a very hard thing to debate here. Is a conservative outlet more profitable than a left-leaning or progressive outlet? Fox News generates a huge amount of cash for the Murdoch family, so it would be killing that golden goose if you materially shifted the strategic direction of Fox News as it currently is.
Neil, you've been covering the Murdochs for decades, including a few books. Sam, as the Financial Review's media reporter, the family is now at the centre of your beat. What do you think happens from here? Will this case end the succession battle, or are there more rounds to come?
Well, first of all, I think there's likely to be a permanent alienation within the Murdoch family, because when your lawyer cross-examines another member of your family, it's not a pleasant process, and there are scars that don't pass easily. But if the three siblings do win their case, then I think Lachlan's position after Rupert's death looks like toast. However way this court case goes, I think that in the end, there is so much money involved, there will be further court cases, there will be appeals. They have money to burn, they will fight and fight, whatever way the judge rules in Reno, this show ain't over.
Whichever way this goes, this will undoubtedly have a huge impact on a media empire that has really been, you know, at the heart of the Western world for decades. And that goes for Rupert Murdoch as well. He has been at the centre of these huge sort of changes in the media ecosystem. And he seems like this sort of immortal, you know, all-powerful man. And he's not. He's 93 years old, but one day he is going to die. And when he dies, those companies will be just a little bit more vulnerable without Rupert behind them. And spare a thought for Anna Murdoch, who's split from Rupert created this trust and who really tried to avoid some sort of acrimonious end to the succession question. And look at where we are. The family is bitterly divided at a courtroom in Reno, Nevada, divvying up the world, one of the world's most powerful media organisations.
Thanks, Sam. Thanks, Neil.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks, Lisa.
Thank you for listening to The Fin. I'm Lisa Murray, with Sam Buckingham-Jones and Neil Chenoweth reporting today. The Fin is produced by Alex Gow and Lapfan. Fiona Buffini is the executive producer. Our theme is by Alex Gow. If you like the podcast and want to hear more, consider sharing it or writing a review, as it helps us reach more people, and follow wherever you get your podcasts. For more stories about markets, business and power, subscribe to The Financial Review at afr.com/subscribe. See you next week for the second part of our succession series.
The Australian Financial Review.